Film Above and Beyond, which is an American film. I'm 52 at the Japanese film by Akira Kurosawa. I live in here, 55. But before I start with my talk about the first of them, Above and Beyond, I would like to say a few words in relation with what we saw last week. Chinese film on the rape of Nanjing, Flowers of War, on the question of aesthetics. So I already insisted on this, that this seminar is on cinema taken into account as basically an industry that is a manufacturer for narratives or some kind of sort of machine, a machine which is used for producing, generating discourses, or if you prefer, in Marxist terms, an apparatus, an ideological apparatus. So all this, rather than cinema, taken into consideration as an art. Okay, I mentioned this already, I insist on it, but there is a but. This, of course, does not mean at all that aesthetic stakes do not matter or would not matter for our subject. It is just the opposite. And this is what I would like to dwell on a bit. So, for we do not have only to spot out or to analyze, to decipher subliminal or explicit messages. We do not have only to deconstruct situations and characters. We also have to be very watchful on the way the film is addressed to us and is intended to affect us. That is, the dimension of the film as perceptible, tangible object. That is a part for us of the tangible world. And I borrow all these terms from the French philosopher Jacques Rancière, his book, notably his book, The Cinematographic Fable, it's called in French. I don't know, I imagine it exists in English. So I would like, and this in order to make this issue quite clear, I would like to mention briefly a discussion, which is a very classical discussion, on a film which in France has become quite paradigmatic. It was at the beginning of the 60s, last century, as a film shot by an Italian director who is called Guido Pontecorvo, and the film's title is Capo, as this film was released, so in Italy, in France, and so on. Pontecorvo was, at the time, a well-known filmmaker, known as somebody who was politically committed to all kind of leftist causes, the Marxists, the communists, anti-colonialists, etc. And he has shot, I think it's his film, which is most known by him, La Bataille d'Alger, film on the war in which Algerians have been involved as they fought for their independence against French colonialism. This film is called The Battle of Algiers. So, okay, but it's not about this film. It's about Capo, which is a film he shot at the beginning of the 60s, a film about German concentration camps. In short, it's about the story of a woman from Jewish origin, who has been sent to camp, concentration camp, and moved there, falls in love with a Russian prisoner. But this is not what matters for our purpose. And I just say, by mention, just by passing, the actress who plays that woman's role is a French actress, Emmanuelle Riva, who is also known for, she performed in the famous film by Alain René, Hiroshima Mon Amour, which is a film we will have to mention, and I imagine more than that, because it is part of our corpus. So, at the end of this film, Capo, this woman commits suicide by rushing up to the electrified barbed wire, which surround the camp. And after the film, just after the film was released, a French filmmaker, well known as a protagonist of the Nouvelle Vague, but also film critic, Jacques Rivette, okay, some of his, maybe you have heard or seen some of his films, notably Céline et Julie vont en bateau. So Rivette, as a young filmmaker and film critic at that time, wrote a very devastating negative article on Capo, and this in the journal of the cinematographic critic in France at that time, Les Cahiers du Cinéma. And one sentence of this article has become quite famous, is very often quoted, mentioned, even today, in all kinds of contexts. And this sentence is about a short sequence which comes at the end of the film as Emmanuelle Riva, this prisoner, woman, throws herself on the barbed wire. Rivette writes, I translate, I did translate as I could because it's not so easy, a lot of technical terms. I hope my translation is understandable. So I quote in my translation, the man, so this guy, the filmmaker, Ponte Corvo, the man who decides at that moment, so in this sequence, to track in, we say in French, to make a trapping, to track in, before he frames, he frames the dead body in low angle shots by taking good care of inscribing, entering, cadre, the raised hand, of course, of the dead woman's body, in his final frame, or centering, if you prefer. This man, that is the filmmaker, the director, just deserves our deepest contempt. This is what Tibet wrote, and which has remained in all the memory of people who care about cinema in France. And this sentence, I must say, has stuck to Kotekovo's career and reputation until his death. He died a few months ago. So my problem is not at all to know if or to judge if Rivette was right or not in uttering this anathema. This is a question I leave to you, to your judgment. But what I want to insist on, and what I'm sure of, is that Rivette is 100% right on this special issue. Very often in films, aesthetic stakes are also simultaneously, they are also ethical and political stakes. It is absolutely true that under certain circumstances, in the special context of a film, a track in or a track out, a close up, a slow motion, or the opposite, an accelerated motion, a special effect, an accumulation of special effects, an ellipsis, etc. All this is liable to be a moral fault or to be the vector of a political manipulation, that is a misdemeanor. And why is it so? It is so because it shows, this kind of manipulation shows that the filmmaker, all the people who surround him, they do not respect the public. They violate the implicit contract the filmmaker, his team, have with the spectator. For the filmmaker, in such a case, takes unfair advantage of the technical means and devices he has at his disposal to manipulate this public and to treat the public, to treat the people who are watching his film as a bunch of idiots. So, in such a case, our task, our critical task, as we are supposed to be vigilant, alert, trained, enlightened public, it is, I think, to catch this liar, this swindler in the act, to take him red-handed like a thief and to expose his imposture. And why do I insist on this issue? It's for me, very obvious reasons. In the kind of films we have to deal with, this question of, let's say, the moral failing or the moral lapse, which goes through aesthetic tricks and devices, this question is very topical. If you take last week's film, so Flowers of War, you very easily will find dozens of examples of what Rivette is talking about. So this is why I insist on this issue. Please be watchful on this. If you love cinema as an art, you absolutely have to be intolerant, to be inflexible every time you notice that the film doesn't respect you, or the people who shot this film do not respect you, as you are supposed to be a rational subject, a moral person, or as you're supposed to be an enlightened spectator, major enlightened. And you have to be intolerant to what I call, the intolerable. And in many of the films we have to deal with here, this intolerable, you will meet it everywhere. So please do not let the greedy industry and the cynical ideological apparatus take you hostages. So now let's just see the famous rabbit. And then you can show it. It takes 30 minutes. Minutes. Seconds. What to think about it and what to think about what Hillel said, of course. Okay. Now I will talk a bit about Above and Beyond. I don't know if some of you succeeded in seeing it. Anyway, we will see longer clips of it than what we used to see until now. It's experimental. It's more pleasant and comfortable to see longer extracts of the film. So we'll try this way. This week, maybe we have to change again next week. So I just present the film, and then we will see these extracts. So let's explore now some phrase or tracks on the question of cinema on about Hiroshima and Nagasaki. I use Hiroshima and Nagasaki as some kind of a syntax together, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So we saw, as for the rape of Nanjing, that the problem for the Chinese filmmakers, but as well for a German director, Florian Gallenberger, was to bring out this event, that is a disaster, a crime, as a stake for collective memory. It was to make out of it a filmic narrative for this event's memory has to be kept in the present. That is the director's of this film's conviction. Each of these films has, from this angle, a commemorative value, even if it is also on its back, let's say, or reverse, it is also, of course, a matter of business. All these films are, to some extent, and from different angles, shot from the viewpoint of the victim. Of the victims. And this is the reason why, to my knowledge of course, I may be wrong, no Japanese fiction film or drama on this issue has been shot. In Above and Beyond, so you have the plot at the end of the paper, if you haven't seen it. So in Above and Beyond, which is a film which has been shot by two American directors, Frank Panama and Melvin Friend, in 1952, a film which has been produced by one of the majors of that time, Metro Goldwyn Mayer, with well-known actors playing the leading roles, Robert Taylor, as Colonel Paul Tibbets, so that is the commander of the Air Force group which conducted the bombings on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and another well-known actress, Eleanor Parker, who performs as his wife. So with this film, in this film, the directors project purpose is exactly the opposite of what we saw with the film about the rape of Nanjing. For their purpose in Above and Beyond is to, I would say, dissolve the problem, to make it vanish, disappear, in a very banal family drama. The problem, we know what it is this unmistakable crime against humanity, which always was denied and evaded as such by his authors, and for which his victims, direct and indirect, never had an opportunity to call the perpetrators to account or to seek redress. For this reason, for this, of course, for the reason we all know, which is very massive and simple, nobody is in position to ask a victim for an explanation about the crimes he has committed in the course of a war or in the course of a conquest. So how do these filmmakers, in Above and Beyond, how do they achieve, how can they achieve this feat of skill? It is, in terms of narration, in the construction of the narrative, it is both, I would say, simple, elementary, very simple, and very brutal, very crude, very rough and vulgar. So it goes this way. First, you dodge the issue by putting the problem into words which make it unrecognizable. Instead of asking the question, can we consider dropping the bomb or the bombs on Japan, knowing that this action would usher in a complete new era, this completely new epoch in which mankind is endowed with the capacity to destroy itself as a whole? So the question, as it is posed, for example, by the German philosopher, Carl Jaspers. So as Jaspers does in his well-known book, The Atomic Bomb and the Future of the Man. So instead of asking this elementary basic question, you just ask in the film, do we Americans, do we have the right to kill 100,000 persons in order to save 1 million persons, that is 500,000 American soldiers plus 500,000 Japanese soldiers and citizens? That is the way you displace the question. Of course, it's easy to imagine. From the moment on, you have accepted, you accept the terms of this biased question. It will not, after that displacement of the question, it will not take long before you find the correct answer. You will see it in the film. In a few seconds, it is solved. So, after the problem has been solved in such an elegant and hasty way, then you can pass to other questions, which are supposed to be, for the American public of the film, at the time that the film is released, which are supposed to be of much greater significance. And first of all, this question. To what extent can or may a professional soldier who is committed to a secret mission, that is preparations for the nuclear bombing of some Japanese cities, to what extent can such a man, or a man in such a position, sacrifice his family life on the altar of discipline, obedience, and of course, of the higher interests of war. So we can pass, we can displace ourselves, we can switch from questions like, do we really, basic questions, fundamental questions like this, do we really know what we do by developing this nuclear program? What we really do by dropping these bombs on Japan? Do we really get the measure of what this decision means for mankind and for human condition? Or can our historical and ethical imagination be equal to our techno-scientific capacities on such an end? Issue, and here I refer to the writings well known today at last of Günther Anders in his book, his most important book, The Outdatedness of Human Beings. So by scaling abruptly down, by displacing from a dilemma to another, we can easily, as we will see in the film, we can easily erase a matter of life and death, that is the inaugural use of the atomic weapon, and replace it with trivial questions the ordinary man or woman is very familiar with, the average American public of this time. And questions like, how can a married man who has been entrusted with a very important mission by his superiors and who cannot share anything of it with his wife, for it is an ultra-secret mission, how can such a man, a family man, do his duty without ruining his family life? You shouldn't believe that I caricature or exaggerate, you will see in the film. This is really exactly the level of the rhetoric of the Greeks which this film is using. And it is always, of course, a very fascinating, gripping question one can ask himself. How do perpetrators relate, how do they narrate the crimes they have committed? It's a very crucial question. It has often been pointed out in the West, in Western Europe, that there exists, actually, there exists no Nazi narrative about the Holocaust. This has not been existed at the time of the perpetration of this crime, and this has not been elaborated after either. Of course, the Nazis, at least a part of them, have had to answer for their crimes, but this without ever setting up such a narrative. And this for the basic reason that their criminal undertaking, so the so-called final solution, has constantly been based on the stubborn denial of the existence of such a project. So there cannot be a narrative from their viewpoint, a narrative of it from their point. But here, in the case I'm dealing with here, from the angle of narratives, it's completely different. Why? First of all, of course, because the culprits never had to answer for a crime which has nevertheless, in spite of the fact that this crime has changed the course of human history, and has transformed our condition. I quote Anders, another book by Anders, The Time of the End. From now on, and as long as we, that is mankind, will live, we will live as mortal species. So, for the culprits in that case, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they have won the war and they have committed this crime in the name or for the sake of freedom and democracy. So they can feel free to stick stubbornly to the propagandist version they worked out at the time they prepared the raid on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. To be sure, they don't like so much to dwell on this issue. And we can see, if you look at the problem from the Hollywood angle, we see that Hiroshima Nagasaki never became, let's say, the goose that lays golden eggs for Hollywood, by contrast with the war in the Pacific in general, which is such a goose. There are actually very few fiction films or dramas which have been produced by the American film and industry and which explicitly deal and at length with Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And this is why, this is the reason why I have to dwell on this very rather bad mediocre film shot by two almost unknown directors with actors you will see on duty doing the job, and doing the job in the same sense as I would say Colonel Paul Tibbets did his job as he dropped the bomb on Hiroshima. So the denial of the crime doesn't go in that case through silence, as in the case of the Nazi crimes. Here, the denial of the crime goes through what I would like to call effacement of the crime, which is something different from distortion or pure lie. The working out of a version of this criminal action, which would be presentable to the American or in general to the Western public of that time, is not so easy. So it has to go through a series of displacements and substitutions, which are meant for coding it in such a way that it cannot be recognized and identified as what it is, that is, a crime not only against the Japanese people as a whole, but also mankind. This form, we can notice by passing, that this form of displacement has, to be sure, something in common with what Freud describes as the work of the dream, and this in his famous book on the interpretation of the dreams, but I would say it is some kind of industrial or commercial use of displacement. So what has to be eluded is, before all, naturally, the problem of responsibility. And I would say the problem of responsibility much more than issues which could be presented as it is usually commonly done in terms of shame or guilt. In the key scene of the bomb dropping on Hiroshima, you will see it, the Tibbets appears to be slightly, imperceptibly, disturbed as he utters mission accomplished. And this just after having dropped the bomb. But at no moments he questions the institutional device, or let's say the rationality of the system according to which obedience as a duty, as a norm, really is converting an unprecedented crime into a moral imperative. The defacement of the crime goes over the metamorphosis of the, let's say, the innocent culprit. That is, he who does the job, but without being aware of the crime or the criminal dimension of what he's doing. So it goes over this metamorphosis, the metamorphosis of this culprit into this energetic man you will see in the film, who is torn between two imperative, let's say, obligation systems. On one hand, professional duty, on the other hand, family obligations. As Hannah Arendt, or as well Günther Anders would say, what Tibet's in short is short of, sorry, what Tibet's is short of, it is imagination or autonomy of imagination or autonomy of the personal judgment, which would be the conditions, the necessary conditions, which could make it possible for him to grasp with the criminal dimension of the unprecedented crime is about to be a direct key agent of. And what replaces imagination as a critical faculty is this fanatic way to stick to the rules. There's to be this small wheel in the machine of the machine. That is his perfect, typical professional ability. And we have to say, we have to admit that from this angle, this man of duty is not very different from the sort of obedient bureaucrat and criminal civil servant Anna then describes in her book on Eichmann. And of course, this is where the film makes sense by running over the intentions of his promoters and sponsors. The Colonel Tibbets, as we see him in the film, as portrayed in the film, is loyal to his superiors as he is to his wife, the same way. He loves his children. But all this in a rather rigid, automatic way, as if he suffered from a deficit, a deficiency in terms of sentiments and emotions. The actor, Robert Taylor, lends a rather memorial face to this rigid character. Obviously, Tibbets has to play a part which is much too wide, much too vast, too big for him. And this is why he's just the man of the situation. He's just as his place, doing what he has been told to do without thinking or discussing. So he will pay his tribute to his family spirit by this anecdote is famous, by nicknaming the B-29 hit pilots over Hiroshima with his mother's name, Enola Gay. And besides, he never forgets to bring back home a perfume bottle for his wife as he comes back, so from one of his frequent and secret missions. And here we have to remember that the Kitsch as a style, Kitsch always has very narrow relations or very deep affinities with this kind of modern or contemporary political criminality or delinquency, which are an exception to any norm or standard. Kitsch, for example, is well known. Kitsch, you find it everywhere in Nazi or Stalinist cultures, in the films, in architecture, everything. In the credits of the film, you will see at the beginning of the film, the army is, and this is very usual in this kind of film, the army is thanked for its support and collaboration. But if you look a bit more carefully at the process of, let's say, manufacturing of the film, you will notice that, let's say, the scenarist of the film has been, at the time of the war, a colonel in the Air Force Reserve. You will notice that several technical advisors have been directly involved in the Hiroshima and Nagasaki operations. And you will even notice that the subject of the film has been, you can find this in the Wikipedia article, it seems that the subject of the film has been inspired, or to the filmmakers, or maybe to the MGM, to the major who produced it, by, I quote, the high rate of divorce among flight crews of the kind Tibet was on off. So you can see that in such a case, this film, the army is not only a support, the army is not only helpful, it is integral part of the production of the film. So what we have to deal with such a film, it's a co-production between Hollywood and the army. Literally speaking, it's a co-production, Hollywood, army. And what shows it eloquently is that after the film was released, and since it is a docudrama, that is docudrama, that is film about the life and the deeds of called Tibet, the real Tibet, still alive and in good shape at that time, and is alias for the film, that is Robert Taylor, they went touring together for the promotion of the film. So, two points at the conclusion. Important things, matter for reflection. The film can be defined, this film can be defined as a device whose effect may be direct intention or not, I do not know, but the effect, it is visible, it's a preventive effect. The function of the film is to block, to hinder our understanding of what the film is really, actually about. That is not only a situation, a war event, but the birth of a new form of power of our life in general, and not only as war is usually in its traditional forms, on power on people, nations, empires, etc. And this is why this syntagm or this neologism, Hiroshima Nagasaki, is meant for designing the radical novelty of what Günther Anders calls the nuclear or the atomic situation, which is something which lasts forever after Hiroshima, Nagasaki. Hiroshima, Nagasaki is the name of this event whose definition is that it never ends, that it can never pass. It's never over. And this film, among other devices, is meant for repelling any kind of critical thought from the surroundings of this event. Second point, as a professional soldier who dedicates himself to the fight against Japanese militarism and fascism, as also a husband, a father who loves his family, as an ordinary man who does his best to reduce the tensions between his professional commitments and his family life, Tibbetts, of course, I mean Tibbetts of the film, Tibbetts is a rather typical and almost exemplary democratic subject. From this angle, is very close to any spectator of the film. And the problem for us is that the distinctive feature of Hiroshima Nagasaki as an event is that this event bursts into pieces the strict opposition between democratic and totalitarian, as Hannah Arendt puts it in her classic book, The Origins of Totalitarianism. Sign for this is the disconcerting psychic affinities Tibbetts displays, even in the film, with figures which obviously belong to the totalitarian side of the contemporary history. I already mentioned Eichmann, as Anna Fenn describes him. And this shows how the strict distinction which is set up by Arendt in The Origins of Totalitarianism doesn't pass, I would say, does not pass the Hiroshima Nagasaki test. And what, as we speak of psychic affinities, what I mean is all what is linked to the issue, let's say, insensitivity or insensibility, that is all this domain of inability of the perpetrator to just to imagine, get the picture of what he's doing and of the consequences of it. On this issue, I must say, Anders is much more interesting than Arendt. Okay, that was what I had to say on this here. So now we can see parts of it. Okay, and now we will skip the second thing, because obviously we don't have time, and I will show you something which can go the same direction indeed, which is, I think, quite horrible. It's a Japanese documentary film, maybe NH, I'm not too sure. And there is in it a passage about women from Hiroshima who have been burned, who have heavy scars on their body and on their faces, and they are invited in the 50s or yes, to the United States for aesthetic surgery. And on this occasion, something happened on television, and this is what I would like to show you, which is a very obvious thing. You will see and see. I will read my presentation of the film by Kurosawa, and we will see it next time. Okay? So, I repeat, the title of this film is I Live in Fear. And you have the plot at the end of the page. So, it is a story of an old man. And this old man is living, so in Tokyo, is the owner of land. And he's living under the terrifying influence of the memory of, as we saw, what doesn't pass, the past which does not pass, that is Hiroshima, Nagasaki, as trauma. And he's so scared by this memory that he has become a nuisance for his family. That is, his family as a symbol of all those who, on the opposite, want to forget and want just to see to their business. That is, at the time that the film was shot, we built Japan as quick as possible, make money, etc. Hiroshima Nagasaki has become his obsession, the old man's, his name is Nakajima, this old man's obsession, his edifice. And for this reason, he's considered as a sick person. His family, his relatives, his children think that he has gone completely insane, he's mad. And this, of course, suits them for many reasons which are not very favorable. This old man is, I would say, the filmic or cinematographic double of the philosopher Gunther Anders, I already spoke about. Anders, whom having stated after the war that Hiroshima Nagasaki is the problem, the even philosophy, contemporary philosophy has to deal with in the new era. For this reason, Anders always was ostracized in his milieu, I mean academic philosophy. He became the perfect outsider of the academic institution after his immigration to the United States. He is from Austria, Austrian, from Jewish origin. And as after his immigration to the United States, instead of teaching, making research, like most of other intellectual philosophers, even with an academic background, he had to work in a factory as a blue collar for many years. And at the same time, as you know, his former wife, because he was the first husband of Hannah Arendt, of course, Hannah Arendt became famous in the United States. So, I would say Anders is the philosophical equivalent of this old man in Kurosawa's film. Or is the madman, this madman, who goes crying, shouting, yelling in the wilderness of contemporary philosophy. Hiroshima is everywhere. Hiroshima is überall. It's the title of one of the many books Anders has written on the what he calls the academic situation. Let's pass now to the narrative device of Kurosawa's film. This narrative device appeals, Kurosawa appeals to, is I think very familiar to any reader of Henry James. I mean here in particular the term of the school and the life. And this device, this narrative device, I call it the undecidable. It's not very correct, but okay, let's say the undecidable. I think David, I use this word as it speaks English. What does it mean, undecidable? It means that as you watch the film, you are constantly shifting, swinging from one interpretation, reading, if you prefer, to another. You're wondering if the old man, Nakajima, is really mad, really suffers from nerves, or if maybe, on the opposite, he might be the only one who is clear-headed in this post-Hiroshima Nagasaki era. That is, if he, maybe, would be the last one who sees what the real situation is, and this in a world, in a society, people with blind and unconscious automata. Of course, very probably, he's both. And this is what makes things complicated in the narration of the film. For this old man's madness is the reverse, it has a name of his clear sightedness. For he has understood, and this in contrast with the voluntary blindness of all the others, he has understood that Hiroshima Nagasaki has, as Anders says, changed everything, and that mankind, from this event on, lives under the sign of this inconceivable collective death threat. I just a small digression by passing, if you are interested, in this device, the indecidable. You find it in a very beautiful other film which belongs to our corpus, which is The Cain Newton, a wonderful film by Edward Mitrick with Humphrey Bogart as the best of his art. And notice just by passing that this film was shot by the same Mitrick who shot the horrible Behind the Rising Sun we talked about, which shows that things are never so simple in Hollywood culture. So, okay, I close the parenthesis. This man, Nakajima, yes, of course, he's crazy in the very common sense, ordinary sense of the term. For what could make it so urgent for him and his family to sell all his properties, as he intends to do it, all his goods, his plants, and all the rest, and to flee to Brazil immediately. Of course, this is preposterous. This is absurd. And why should it be safer, as one of his relatives asked him in the film at the moment, one of the scenes of the film, why should it be safer in Brazil, even in Amazonia, than in Japan, in case of an atomic apocalypse? So his madness consists in seeing the new situation in terms of imminent danger, immediate danger, and not of, let's say, persistent, more or less vague threats. Hiroshima, of course, we know that Hiroshima is everywhere. This does not mean that the nuclear war is going to break out tomorrow, and that a radioactive cloud will hang over Tokyo in the coming minutes. So his madness is this. He overreacts to this threat. But on the other hand, this overreaction is just the matching piece to all the others' refusal to take this mortal danger into consideration. So his madness is a reversed out reflection of his societies, of the societies living in madness. That is, of the way his contemporaries bury their heads in the sand. What is signed here by Kurosawa, it's of course post-war Japan, which is rushing forward in the reconstruction. So this old man sees in advance what the next developments of the Hiroshima-Nagasaki theme will be, that is, at the time after or at the time of Cold War, the weapons race, including nuclear weapons, and after that Chernobyl, Fukushima, etc. For the time as the film was shot, that is just a decade after the two nuclear bombs were dropped, we should remember that this film was Kurosawa's answer to an incident which had been in the news 2 years before, 1953. That is this well-known incident, the irradiation of Japanese fishermen who were fishing with their boat close to the atoll picking, and this on the occasion of a nuclear test carried out by the US Army. So from this angle, this old man, he's a prophet. He's a prophet because he sees things the others don't see, and he sees far ahead. But, of course, his agitation, restlessness, makes the others feel insecure. And, as we know, the border between madness and prophecy, or the condition of prophet or a prophet, this border is often very vague, slim. What makes things even more complicated is that the old man's madness, this alleged madness, it is political. The object, the material of his alleged madness is human history. It is the historical texture of the present. And this is why it is so dangerous for the other living, that is, for those who shut their ears, eyes, and mouth on the issue Hiroshima, this issue Hiroshima-Nagasaki raised. Those who prefer to ignore what kind of, let's say, brand new world we live after Hiroshima, Nagasaki. And this is the reason why the old man has to be locked up in a madhouse. You will see at the end of the film, this is a very beautiful sequence as he's locked up in the madhouse. And this is a film which questions the public, which addresses the public. Not a film which tries to convince or to send a message, but it's calling the public to witness. Who is man, actually? Who is man? Is it this disarmed prophet who challenges all the social norms and who, for this reason, collides so openly with the consensus which has been set up in Japan at the time of Reconstruction? Who is mad? Or maybe his contemporaries who don't want to see that the nuclear sword of Damocles hangs over their heads. Maybe they are the madmen. According to Günther Anders, the lack of attention and what Anders calls absent-mindedness. This absent-mindedness of those who live in the post-Hiroshima Nagasaki era, this is part of the system. This is a side effect or a direct consequence of the radical novelty of this kind of massive destruction device. Anders says in another book, which is called The Time of the End, and this is not a quote, it's, okay, I rephrase it from the French translation of it. So what Anders says is this: because it is so tremendous, the threat of a nuclear war requires too much from our limited capacities of understanding, that is in terms of perception as well as in terms of imagination. In other terms, the fact that the possible disaster which hangs over us after Hiroshima and Nagasaki lies so much beyond our capacities in terms of imagination, this has the paradoxical effect that we become indifferent to the possible or virtual apocalypse. We go about to our business as if nothing had changed. In the countries that belong to the very exclusive nuclear club, the ruling elite puts in a lot of efforts in order to anesthetize the public sphere just by calling the nuclear weapon a deterrent, that is, on the whole, a way to keep peace. And this is exactly what Anders called the minimalization business of the rules. So, what Nakajima, the old man, feels very intensely is that the catastrophe, the disaster, is already here. For the destruction of our world can take place at any moment. And this is why he lives in fear, as he said. But it is not only this. His fear transforms itself into anguish, into distress, as you will see in the film. And this because he cannot share his fear with anybody. And this is very typically the linguistic situation, or dead end, which Jean-François Lyotard describes in the famous first pages, the beginning of his book, The Different. What situation? There is a plaintiff. And this plaintiff cannot, he doesn't succeed in having his complaint lodged, that is taken into consideration by the court of anything similar to that. More specifically, in that case, in the case of our old man in Kurosawa's film, it is the typical situation in which a subject shouts to the public, and this in order to draw the public's attention to something which is, for this subject, a vital, immediate issue. So he or she shouts, don't you see this, don't you see that, etc. And nobody listens to him or her. And the people who are there, passers-by, they just walk along. We can notice by passing that filmmakers are very fond of this kind of situation. I can mention here a beautiful film by Michael Haneke, Time of the Wolf, another film which is everybody knows, that film, John Schlesinger, Marathon Man, less known French film by René Alliot, who's called Le Paul, etc. So this, what I call the don't you see issue, is extremely trying for the subject who knows that he knows or that she knows and sees something that has to be urgently shared with other people, and that still no other is willing to share with him. And this is a situation which can drive this subject on the verge of despair, of hysteria, of madness. Example, the examples I was in other films, I was thinking of. In Marathon Man, you have an old man who has survived the Holocaust. He's walking in a street and he suddenly just like bumps into a Nazi who was active in one of the camps where this man has been sent to. So a war criminal, he recognizes him in the crowd, in a busy street of New York, in a Jewish area. So the old man immediately shouts, stop this man, stop him, he's a criminal, he's a Nazi. But okay, people go, and nobody pays attention to what the old man shouts. And okay, the old Nazi can take to his heels, and okay, just only some people take notice of the old man and think he's a lunatic, he's crazy. In Haneke's film, it's a film which describes sort of a civil war, post-catastrophic conditions, something very dark. And at the beginning of the film, a man is killed in front of his wife and his children. And, okay, father in the film, that woman, the wife of the man who has been killed by his criminals, she thinks that she recognizes her husband's killers in a scene as she with her children are seeking refuge in some kind of a humanitarian camp. So she shouts, she exhorts, she begs the people around to stop these men, saying, okay, these people are criminal, they have killed my husband, I recognize them. But these men, they keep very calm, they keep cool, and they said, okay, we never saw this woman, we don't understand why she's doing this. Anyway, we do not even know the place she's mentioned. So we, as public, we really cannot decide, we do not know. And it's the same for the people she's taking as witnesses, and nothing happens. Okay. And it's the same structure of the situation which we find in Kurosawa's film. And what is extremely impressive in Kurosawa's film is this. The pathetic and desperate, don't you see, etc., which is uttered by the old man, has absolutely no relation with a personal problem, conflict, issue, but with the situation in general, which is the historical fate, not only of Japan after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but, I repeat, of mankind as a whole. Nakajima is the hallucinated, or maybe clairvoyant, witness of this new history. And finally, what Kurosawa is asking us, actually, is something, it's a very exciting question. Can fear be a good guide? Can fear be a good advisor? As we have to be equal to this task, is understand what our epoch is made of, what our historical area is substantially made of. Does fear and anguish always cloud our judgment? And very obviously, as you would see, the film leaves the question quite open. One thing is sure, of course, Kurosawa is very critical of the post-historical attitude of his contemporaries in post-war Japan. That is very critical of their acceptation of the general conditions of a very, let's say, materialistic reconstruction, money, family, business, and so on. And, okay, one point of a conclusion. Very obviously, it is much more difficult for an institution, and in particular for a state, much more difficult for so institutions, states, than for individuals, human persons, to acknowledge its faults, that is to admit that it, a state, has done wrong to a community, to a group of persons, to a nation, etc. And to face up its responsibilities for this wrong, for crimes committed in the past. It seems to be a matter of principle, or principles, for some states. It seems to be something deeply rooted in their rulers' mentality. It seems to be something which is part and parcel of the raison d'etat in these countries. It seems to be a national point of honor. Never to feel responsible and to take upon itself the responsibility for crimes which have been perpetrated in the past by a public authority housing power today are the successors of. The inclination to denial is very distinct, especially in countries which have a colonial or an imperial past, which are or have been great powers, let's say. A country like France, whose rulers always had, in modern history, a very marked imperial mentality, is quite exemplary, if you can say things that way, on this issue. And the example by
excellence of this Algeria
since the end of the independence war of the Algerians, 1962. None of the people in charge of the public affairs at the top of the states ever has issued a simple and clear statement about the mass crimes and the horrors like torture and so on, which have been perpetrated throughout this conflict in Algeria. And for this reason, the relations between France and Algeria are still continuously poisoned by this denial. As what I consider as the counterexample of post-Nazi Germany, as this counterexample shows, it is not a question of formal apology or assumed repentance. What matters, what always matters, is the way people who have the authority to speak in the name of the nation and the state, the way they do accept or not to lift up or to raise the burden of a common criminal past. And this in front of the victims and facing other nations. What matters in the counter-example I'm referring to here is the way a German Chancellor, that is Chancellor, whatever his political color, is social democrat or conservative Christian democrat, is that he has this ability to deliver a speech in Warsaw, in Poland, and describe openly there, talk openly there about the Nazi regime as criminal. This way of taking the bull by the horns is the only way to open a new chapter on some phase in the relations between two states and nations whose common past has been devastated by massive crimes. The German model, in terms of, let's say, governing or ruling the memory of one's own criminal past, is what I would like to contrast with the politics of denial as empires, former imperial or imperialist states like France or Britain, or today an hegemon like the United States today stick to. The denial of Hiroshima and Nagasaki as a crime against humanity, the refusal to take into consideration one's own criminal past, this is what this film, Above and Beyond, is a perfect illustration of for me. I'm talking then about what I wanted to show, and I didn't succeed to show. So next time we see this, and I leave it here. Okay?